Hi, I'm Shravani. In this video, I give an overview of DPC++ programming and cover basic data types, the execution and memory models, Lambda kernels, and error handling. Make sure to watch the introduction to DPC++ programming video in the links for terminology of heterogeneous platforms used in this video. First, let's talk about the basic data types of DPC++, starting with the device selectors. They are used to select devices to run the kernel code on. The default selector class chooses the most performant device or the host device if no accelerator can be found. We also have other predefined selectors available. Next are queues, which take in device selector instances as a parameter and are used to enqueue kernels for offloading. Kernels are asynchronously scheduled at runtime based on data dependencies in order to ensure correct results. Command groups encapsulate the kernel and data requirements in a Lambda. Then there is the execution model. Each kernel execution results in work items and work groups. A work item is an instance of the kernel body and is similar to a CPU thread. Multiple work items run the same kernel body code in parallel. A work group is a group of work items and each work group uses the device's local memory. The global size is the number of total work items and the local size is the number of work items per work group. Next is the memory model. The memory subsystem is divided into global, constant, local, and private memory. Global memory is accessible to all work groups and can be read from and written to. Constant memory is a read-only part of the global memory and is used by the host. Local memory is for each work group and is allocated per kernel execution. Private memory is similar to a CPU register. It stores variables created in the kernel and is per work item. Now, let's go back to data types. Buffers store arrays of 1 to 3 dimensions. When we pass in a raw pointer to the data and the dimensions of the array to the buffer's constructor, the buffer instance takes ownership of the memory. This is called resource acquisition is initialization, or RAII. When the buffer's scope ends, the buffer instance releases the memory. Accessors access data managed by buffers and are used to define read and write operations. Accessors are declared inside a command group in order to allow the kernel code to access the data. Next is basic Lambda kernels. A single task executes the kernel using a single thread on the device. On the other hand, parallel for executes the kernel body using multiple threads on the device. There are multiple overloads of parallel for in DPC++. Hierarchical kernels are used to specify what to do per work group and per work item. The number of and size per work group are customized. The kernel code within parallel for work group is executed per work group, and the code within parallel for work item is executed per work item. There's also an implicit barrier after each parallel for work item. Here is an example of a hierarchical kernel that uses 64 work groups of 8 work items each. Next is error handling. There are two types of errors in DPC++. First, there are synchronous errors, which are C++ exceptions and are reported immediately. Second, there are asynchronous errors. They occur during the execution of the kernel, which is in the device code and not the host code. Asynchronous errors can be caught using an exception handler. Here is an example of error handling. Now, you have a better understanding of how DPC++ programming functions. Make sure to check out the links for more resources about DPC++ programming and don't forget to download the oneAPI toolkit to try it out for yourself. Thanks for watching.
Hey everybody, I hope you liked this video. If you haven't seen our other videos, make sure you remember to subscribe to the Intel Software YouTube channel. Don't forget to leave us a little comment down below as well to engage with the other enthusiasts who watch our shows.